Okay, this is a continuation of the doctrine of election, and another word that's usually associated or used in replace of election is the word chosen. Okay, who is chosen? Who is chosen for what? Why are they chosen? So I'm going to run through several passages on this idea of the choosing. Okay, Ephesians 1 verse 4 is the usual place where a Calvinist will use as a springboard to promote his idea of Calvinism and or the choosing before the foundation of the world. So we're going to build up to that, come up to that, and then look to see what the Bible actually is saying about choosing. Chronologically, when you run through the Bible, the first time you see that idea is found in Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 6. And this one says, "For thou art an holy people unto the Lord thy God. The Lord thy God hath chosen thee." Chosen thee for what? For salvation? No. Chosen thee for what? And who is he talking to? He's talking to the nation of Israel. He said, "Thy God hath chosen thee to be a special people unto himself above all people that are upon the face of the earth." He repeats that idea in Deuteronomy 14, verse 2. But in Psalm 33, verse 12, he said, "Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, and the people whom he hath chosen for his own inheritance." Okay, this is a choosing of an inheritor of the kingdom of God. Okay, and in this context, again, like the word elect, will be reference to Israel. Okay, in Isaiah 41, in Isaiah chapter 40 through 48, is God sort of bypassing the prophet and does the speaking for himself. In Isaiah 41 verse 8, it says, "But thou, Israel, art my servant, Jacob, whom I have chosen, the seed of Abraham, my friend." Okay, so as election, we now do see with the word chosen, the word servant. Okay, Isaiah 43 verse 10. One of the very subtle deceptions of Satan is he'll take a word and you possibly can have your own personal definition of the word. And it might be a biblical word, but it's misapplied. Okay, and Isaiah 43 verse 10. "Ye are my witnesses, saith the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen." Okay, so there we go. Now we're starting to see a pattern from God himself speaking. Isaiah 44, verse 1. "Yet now hear, O Jacob, my servant, and Israel whom I have chosen. Thus saith the Lord that made thee and formed thee from the womb, which will help thee. Fear not, O Jacob, my servant, and thou, Jeshurun, whom I have chosen." So as election, we can see that a person is chosen for a service. Isaiah 45, verse 4, "For Jacob my servant's sake, and Israel mine elect, I have even called thee by thy name. I have surnamed thee, though thou hast not known me." So we can see, again, God is referring to the word elect and the word chosen to a service, not salvation. Okay, in Matthew 20, verse 16, the Lord said, "Many are called, but few are chosen." I suppose the Alaska interpretation would be many are cold, but few are frozen. But called for what? Well, in Romans 1:7, it says they're called to be saints. Okay? But they're chosen for a service. The choosing is not for salvation. The choosing is for a service. Now, that's the premise if we're going to allow the Bible to define its own terms. Okay, let's see how this will run if that is a faithful definition or usage of the word chosen. John 15:16. Jesus said, "Ye have not chosen me, but I've chosen you." Okay, in this context, the ye would be the apostles. "Ye have not chosen me, but I've chosen you and ordained you that ye should be saved." Is that what it says? No. Okay, what does he chose them to do when he called the apostles? Okay, as far as he chose them out of the 70 disciples. "Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that ye should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain," and so forth. The choosing there is for a service. In this context, the choosing was to bear fruit, not salvation. When somebody misapplies that to salvation, they are following a satanic interpretation, where a satanic interpretation takes a truth of another age or a word and misapplies it. In Acts 9, verse 15, the Lord said about the apostle Paul, he said, "Go therefore, for he is a chosen vessel unto me." What for? "To bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel." Paul, Saul at the time, was called to be Saint Paul, got saved. He was chosen as a chosen vessel to bear God's name. That's a service. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 27, it shows generally the type of people that God chooses. In 1 Corinthians 1:27, "For God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, and God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty, and the base things of the world, and things which are despised hath God chosen, yea, and the things which are not to bring to naught things that are." That's a choosing of a ministry. That's a choosing of a service. Okay, and then Paul reinforced this idea in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 4, where he said this. He said, "No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier." Okay, so now, what about that Ephesians 1, 4, and 5 passage? Okay, so this is the springboard. Mr. Proponent of Calvinism is going to try to hang his hat on. So he says this, "According as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love." Now, what's the choosing in Ephesians 1:4? The Calvinist is going to say that God chose me to salvation before the foundation of the world. I was doing some door knocking in a very, very small town. I mean, probably no more than 15 houses. Came across an elderly lady, and she told me she attended a primitive Baptist church. Okay, she named the church, but it's a primitive Baptist. So I knew what I was dealing with. So I thought, oh, okay, I'm going to try a little different method with here. And I said to her, I said, oh, okay, tell me, when did you get put in Christ? She said, before the foundation of the world. And I said, oh, really? You don't look that old. Now, she was probably in her mid-70s, but she definitely wasn't almost 6,000 years old. And the idea never dawned on her before. Why? She wasn't present before the foundation of the world. Now, here is the temptation of Mr. Calvinist, where he will focus upon himself. You see, when God chose me, he got a bargain. And so they tend to sort of kind of go to their head. So here's how they read Ephesians 1:4. According as he hath chosen us, see that, look, us, he chosen us in him before the foundation of the world. Now, he doesn't usually read the rest of the verse because that shows actually the purpose of the choosing, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. But you see, the self-deceived Calvinist who is enamored with himself because God chose him will focus upon he hath chosen us. What if you focus on in him? According as he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world. The choosing was that salvation was going to be in Jesus Christ. And when you get in Jesus Christ by freely accepting him, then he wants you to be holy and without blame before him in love. Who was present before the foundation of the world? Not me. I wasn't here. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 19 says, but with the precious blood of the Lamb, of Christ, I'm sorry, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot, who verily was foreordained before the foundation of the world and was manifest in these times for you. God chose before the foundation of the world that salvation was going to be found in Jesus Christ, because the Lord Jesus Christ was here before the foundation of the world. You and I were not. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 13 states, but we are bound to give thanks always to God for you, brethren, beloved of the Lord, because God hath from the beginning chosen you to salvation. Now, if there was a period right there, I would say, okay, you're interpreting Ephesians 1:4 correctly, chosen to salvation. But the sentence keeps going. What was the choosing? Chosen you to salvation through sanctification of the Spirit and belief of the truth. That's the method of salvation that God has chosen. Then it says, whereunto he called you by our gospel. That's where Romans 1:7 says you're called to be saints to the obtaining of the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, so that's the choosing. Revelation 17:14 mentions called, chosen, faithful. Called, called to be saints. Chosen, chosen to a service or for a service. Faithful, you were faithful to that service. You see, in reality, no one can freely choose to accept the viewpoint of Calvinism. You can't do it. You must be predestinated before the foundation of the world to be a Calvinist. But I myself discovered that I was predestinated before the foundation of the world not to be a Calvinist. Now, in Luke chapter 10, the Lord Jesus Christ goes to the home of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. And Martha is busy making a meal for the Lord Jesus, and Mary is sitting at the feet of the Lord Jesus. And now Martha, as a typical sister, says to the Lord, you know, would you tell her to help, please help me? Tell her to help me. Okay, that you'll find this in Luke 10. And here's how it reads. Now it came to pass as they went that he entered into a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha received him into her house. Good, that's good. She had a sister called Mary, which also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was cumbered about much serving and came to him and said, Lord, dost thou not care that my sister hath left me to serve alone? That's a normal reaction, is it not? Bid her, therefore, to help me. And then Jesus made this statement. Jesus answered and said unto her, Martha, Martha, thou art careful and troubled about many things, but one thing is needful, and Mary hath chosen that good part which shall not be taken away from her. You see, if you are wise, you are to choose what Mary chose. You can choose to allow your preconceived idea or opinions to override the truth. In order to do that, you must continue to change words to stay within your deception. And you must also continue to change words to justify yourself. Or you can take a biblical word and misapply it. But that's of your free will to do that. Or you can choose what Mary chose. She sat at the feet of Jesus and allowed his words to change her beliefs. And that's what a Bible believer does. A Bible believer will learn to change his beliefs to match the book. A Bible corrector is somebody who will change the words of the book or misapply the words of the book in order to make it fit in their little mode. So what is chosen? A person is called to be a saint, but a saint is chosen for a service. And the best choosing you can do is choose what Mary chose and sit at the feet of Jesus and learn from his words.